We are back from our first trip in Nepal. We went through the Langtang Valley. It took us in total 7 days. On the first day I was already a bit ill, and on the second day we had to make a rest day because I couldn't walk anymore because I didn't feel well.
The Langtang National Park is located north of Kathmandu. Kathmandu is down here, and it is a 9-hour bus drive to Zerubezi or Dunche. Both are the gates to the Langtang National Park. And we started our trek on the 25th of April in Zerubezi and went all the way up to Shepagon, that is 1200 meters up and 200 meters down, and is located around 2400 meters. And on the second day we were going to Lama Hotel, that was only a 2 hours walking because of Elizabeth's food poisoning. She got in Zerubezi in the hotel, at least we reckon that it was in the hotel, fried potatoes. And on our third day we are going to Thang Sak Siap village, that is located on 3140, and to go on our fourth day to Kanjin Gumpa. Kanjin Gumpa is already located on 3830 meters, so I had a bit of headache in Kanjin Gumpa. And in Kanjin Gumpa you have different options to go to. One of them is the Kanjin Ri, and the other one is Tsergari. Kanjingri is located on 4,773 meters, where Tsergari is on 4,984. In April, you have to expect on Tsergari snow for the last 200 meters. We have only been in Kanjingri. There was no snow at all. It was in basically easy. We haven't been on Tsergari, but we asked one or two people who have been up there. They say in April, right now, there is snow on the last 200 meters. Otherwise, the walkway up there is pretty much the same as on Kanjingri. So the main reason which one you choose to go to is if you are well acclimatized with being already on 4,000 meters, because it would be mostly a 1,000 meters climb in one day to go to Tsergari, and the chance of headache is much higher than going to the other one. Yeah, and we actually came from Kanjin Gumpa in a 9 hours walk all the way back to Rimshe yesterday, and today it took us 4 to 5 hours back to Zerubezi and to the small star hotel. Also important to notice is that nowadays there is a road going up to Kanjin, so the walkway is partly damaged. Other parts of the walkway are still usable. If you search for it, you can avoid the road for most of the time. Coming back from Rimshe via Bamboo, you will have the last hours of walking a road that is now under construction, and somebody told us it's planned until Lama Hotel for now, and it's a crazy road. It's mainly built into the rock by hand, and then it's straightened by a vehicle to make it better accessible for cars, and there's a huge steel bridge going over the river to support vehicles as well. So it's not the recommended way to go as soon as the road is completely finished with traffic and everything, because it also overbuilds most part of the old walkway. And anyway, I would recommend to go with the description in our main source for treks in Nepal. That is Nepal Trekking from Robin Bustad, published in the Trailblazer book publishing. We bought it in New Zealand for $55, which is ridiculous, because it's around $40. And if you buy a book in the Nepal Map House, you buy $10 for it. But we got that in New Zealand, so we could already start planning before we arrived here. That was very good. And this book recommends you to start in Dunche and go via Tulu Siabru, Rimshe also to Kanjin Gumpa, and climb the Sagari if you are a bit more adventurous, it says in the book. Otherwise, you go for Kanjin Rim. I would recommend if you have plenty of time, you should go for both. First the easier one, then the harder one, and plan at least 3 days for these two ones so you can wait for better weather and good view. You usually only get in the morning, and if you are lucky, because if there's rain coming early, it might be all cloudy. We had just had a very little view as it was actually clearing again in the evening, and we choose to go down the easier side. If you go down the back side, you actually have to go off track, as the track is marked there. You can see a bit of a track, but it sometimes goes over in loose gravel and would be a more difficult track to go down than staying on the two main tracks going up and down. Track starting in Dunsheim, we have a very nice rating system in here, and we are in Langtang Valley. It says it's a comfort, convenience and quality Himalayan experience. You can go in spring and autumn until winter, and either you go tea house or camping. Usually camping means that you camp in the villages next to one of the tea houses. I would not do that, camping next to tea houses, because in spring season the rooms are free and you only pay for your food. Only is good because the food is expensive, but for that we are coming later. If I would go for camping, I would search for wild campsites. They are very limited in the area. You find spots for a single tent, but in a group I would not attempt to tent until Kanjin Gumpa. Behind Kanjin Gumpa you can do camping because there are hardly any village coming. The duration of the trek starting in Dunshe and finishing in Serebesi is 10 days, including 2 days of travel from Kathmandu to Serebesi and back, or Kathmandu to Dunshe and then back from Serebesi, what is actually 9 hours bus drive. If you start in Serebesi and you're already well acclimatized, you can actually, like we do the trek in 6 to 7 days. But we were actually extending too fast. We have done more than 500 meters a day sometimes, above 3000, so, or above 2500. That is not really recommended for feeling comfortable. But if you go via Dunshe and Tulu Siabru, you're already higher up earlier to get used to the height. Tulu Siabru is already on, it's only on 2200, but earlier on, you stay on maybe 3,300 meters. Back to the book. The book has different ratings for different categories. And one is the lowest one and three is the highest category. So if it says Tarong 1, that means that the incline of the track is very little. Navigation 1 means it's basically a walkway used by donkeys and locals, so you can't really get missed. Skill is the question, do you need to be a comfortable walker on uneven ground? That is one. Or three would be you need to have to use ropes and ice pickle. High point 2 means that the track goes above 4,500 meters but stays below 5,500. Ascend, descend 1 says that you don't go more than 500 meters up or 500 meters down in one day. And fitness is the general fitness level required is very low for this track. That doesn't mean that you should be untrained, because it's going to be hard to walk above 3000 meters as the air gets thin and everything is anyway harder. But as it's a fully supplied tea house track, you don't really need to bother about a lot of luggage, so fitness level can be very low to complete this track. If you go for the version we have done, starting in Serebesi and going to Shepagon,
Actually, the trek gets more strenuous, as we have done 1,200 meters in the first day up and 300 meters down. But if you follow the guidebook, you actually have less elevation to cover in one day than we have done.
If you look in the book description, it actually says for the first day, you've finished your bus ride in Danche, but you might catch a jeep or a vehicle that goes in the direction of Zerubezi until the junction of Tulo Barakuru on 1860 meters, or it's 1 hour of walking. Tulo, like the junction would be here, and then you go to Tulo Ziaburu, and you actually don't go on 3000 meters at all in that moment, and you skip walking up basically. So the trek becomes with that version a bit easier. If you really start in Danche, it's actually harder than what we have done, because you end up going from 1960 meters in Danche over 3000 meters and back down. So it would be actually more than 1000 meters up and a couple of 100 meters down. So that one is not recommended to start in Danche if you're untrained. You might choose to finish in Danche or continue on the Hilambu track that goes either to Timbu bus station or all the way down to Kathmandu. But that is a different track. Even so, that one is also rated in this book as basically easy track. It will be more strenuous than the Langtang Valley track, as you have actually a pass on 4,610 meters on the Hilambu track. But if you're already in Langtang and you bring plenty of time, it is recommended to go to the Langtang Valley, followed up by Hilambu.
In Kathmandu, you start your trip with a bus. The local bus costs 450 rupee, and the deluxe bus, which is very basic, costs 600 rupee. That's $6 right now. And yeah, in Zerubezi, where we are right now, we pay 500 rupee per night. Whereas we don't pay for the room at the track usually. We don't eat in the hotel because it's too expensive for us, and go to smaller local restaurants where you have also Kathmandu prices. On the track, you usually make a deal that you get the room for free. Like in this season, in April, it's not the main season, so you can negotiate a bit better and get the room for free. And you also should always negotiate about the portions you get for the price. You normally eat breakfast and dinner with the hotel or guest house to stay in, and you always should ask them for a bigger portion if you want only to eat twice a day and have some snacks for lunch, because it's a bit expensive, and you shouldn't go for a European breakfast because that's not much, and you stay hungry if you only eat one pancake or one slice of bread or one double omelette, which is all like, one double omelette is $4 and one slice of bread is $4 and a pancake is $4 to $5, and yeah, you stay hungry after eating it. So we always went for either tzumeni, like noodles or pasta, or we always went for tzumeni, pasta, or momos, that's dumplings. Momos filled with potato is the cheapest options, mostly between 400 and 450, and they're very good. And you also can try to get a bigger portion. For example, one guest house we got, instead of 10 small momos, one very big momo, which has had a lot more potato in it than the small ones, which is very good. And you also can ask for a bigger portion of pasta. Or if you eat dalbat, you get unlimited rice and other stuff refilled. But dalbat is always 600, so it's not very cheap.
I want to speak about the total expenses we had on our trip, coming from Kathmandu, going to Zerubezi, up to Kanchenjunga, back to Zerubezi, and the bus back to Kathmandu. And we spent for the 1 week, for the 7 days, plus 2 days of travel, we like 9 days in total, we spent $226 for two people. $100 are for the permit and Tim's card, so we spent $126 for food and accommodation, not including the food we are going to eat tomorrow morning and during the bus ride. Yeah, I already mentioned permit and Tim's. The permit is the entry fee to the national park, where the TIMS is called a fee for your safety. So the permit is used for increasing infrastructure within the national park, like building roads and electricity plants, where the TIMS fee is for your rescue and in case of an earthquake or something, the government knows where you are because you get registered at the checkpoints located in Danshi, Zerubezi and Langtang for now in 2018, might change next season. The permit is $30 and the TIMS card is $20 for independent hikers. So it's $50 to go to Langtang Valley for an unlimited time. So you can stay 2 days, but you could also spend a month tramping in the national park. Yeah, that means that $100 of the $226 are permit fees and $126 food and accommodation and transport.